Monday. It's 12 noon. It's super gloomy in Los Angeles. I'm on my way home from therapy right now, and I'm slowly formulating the plan of how I'm gonna shoot this video and include every single pedal in my pedal library. Woke up this morning and decided today is the day that I'm gonna do the complete pedal library rundown. I don't know what that looks like yet, what that's gonna involve, but it is gonna involve every single pedal in my pedal library. Maybe I'm gonna play through all of them. That sounds like a lot of work, and I'm not opposed to doing the work. I just want to present the most interesting video possible and show you guys all of these super fun, funky, cool, hip, sometimes really crappy toys that I have in the pedal library and what I use them for. Some of them have stories behind them. Some of them I got in really weird places. Some of them are stupidly expensive. Some of them are so cheap they were virtually giving them away. And some of them, I gotta say, were free. So I guess it doesn't get a lot cheaper than that. It's not gonna be easy, but it is gonna be fun. Now all I have to do is drive home and start filming. Why don't I start at the beginning with my very first two pedals? I remember going to the Bass Center in Wapping in London. I had asked my mom if I could have one of these pedals, and she had agreed to buy me one pedal. And I wanted an octave pedal, I wanted a chorus pedal, and I knew about these two pedals right here. And I took the subway. It took me like an hour to get there, and by the time I got to the Bass Center in London, she had called and told them to tell me, see, this is before cell phones were around. She called them to tell me that it was okay to have both of those. You can't imagine how happy I was that I was like, wow, because I was debating the whole time. Yeah, maybe she knew that. Maybe she knew I was gonna stew all the way to the store on the subway. Like, which one should I get? God, I really want the octave because I wanna be able to play those, but the Jaco has that chorus sound. Like, which one am I gonna get? And when I got there and found out it was two, I was just over the moon. So these were my very first two effects pedals, the EBS Octobass and the CEB3, the Boss Bass Chorus. Honestly, can't tell you the last time I used them. I think I keep them more for nostalgia than anything. I'm not even sure the Octobass works anymore. That doesn't look too healthy. It's supposed to look like that. It looks like this. They have seen an incredible amount of use. I did probably use them to death in the first 6 months of owning them. Don't use them too much anymore. I was really low-key about pedals for the longest time. Didn't really have any in my arsenal, really didn't have the need for them. I was like a purist, if you like. I was just playing bass and trying to play jazz and all those things. Until I started to work with Jojo Mayer's band with Nerve. That was when, where is it? Here it is, right in the front. That was when this became an absolute essential. This is the Jojo Mayer setting. Everyone uses that. Me, Tim LaFave, John Davis, everyone who's ever played in Nerve uses that setting. That's the Jojo Mayer setting. And that was like the essential first purchase, was an OC2. Not sure whether I had a Japanese one first or a Taiwanese one or whatever it was. I now own about 20 of them. And just talking to Jojo, Jojo explaining pedals to me, explaining electronic music a little more to me, all kinds of things going on there that really started to, you know, push me down the pedal path, so to speak. And then, like a lot of things with me, the more I found out about it, the more interested I was, the more intrigued I was, the more curious I was to find out, okay, wow, what makes all these sounds that I'm hearing that I want to recreate? In fact, I'm sitting here in front of a bunch of pedals. Hang a second, I don't have an essential one here. I remember going on tour with Jojo's band and him buying me one of these, offsetting it against my first paycheck on the tour, because I really wanted to own one and I didn't have the money to buy it. This is the Lemuga Fuga low pass filter. But I remember that was a massive moment getting to own this pedal, Jojo helping me do that and then taking it on the road and really using it to full effect and being able to create all these amazing wows kind of sounds with the octave and the distortion and all those things. Big moment for me in pedals for sure was getting the Lemuga Fuga low pass filter. Along with the Lemuga Fuga low pass filter, I just got curious about all the Moog pedals. You see sitting here is the Fretbox. Great pedal, makes some kind of cool synthy sounds. A little bit glitchy here and there, but I really dig it. The Lemuga Fuga ring modulator. This is such a badass pedal. I played it so much on It Only Happens Once, especially on the tune You Rang, which was all based around the ring modulator. Again, using the expression pedal on the mix, so I can mix it in and out from my dry sound to the totally wet signal. Fast forward a few years after getting into pedals, especially into the Lemuga Fuga pedals, and I'm having a conversation with John Davis. I'm asking him about his pedal board with Nerve and how he gets these kind of presets and all this expression specific stuff. That was the key thing I was hearing. He was very, still is of course, very expressive with the way he plays with those pedals. And he told me, hey man, I'm using this thing, the MP201. Me, in my infinite wisdom, didn't hear MP201. For some reason, I heard CP251, scoured the internet. I was on the road somewhere, I don't remember where, found someone on Craigslist that had it, and bought it and wondered why I couldn't make all the same sounds that John was making with Nerve. I had misheard the model number. At the end of the day, not a problem because now I own both of them and this one they don't make anymore. It might be the most expensive pedal I own. I think these go for over $1,000 on eBay now. I gotta check that because the last time I looked, they were super rare. And it's a CV controller for all the Lemuga Fuga pedals. You can create presets and be very, very expressive with all those pedals. I misheard John Davis all those years ago. I ended up with both pedals. They're really great fun. Both of them are really great fun. I eventually learned how to use this one. I think I was talking to Tim LaFave about it a little bit and he was telling me that if you kind of boost the highs in your distortion pedal, that really helps with the LFOs and the sample and hold. It really helps the way this pedal is triggered. So really great fun to experiment with those pedals, even if I did misunderstand what John has said and totally go out and buy the wrong thing. Once my mind was open to all the possibilities that pedals kind of give me and could allow me to explore, then I went on kind of a mission just to try and find funky, different, weird, quirky things. And they take all shapes and forms, whether they're brand new pedals from new builders. Like I love Iron Ether. I love Taylor over at Iron Ether. The Frantabit is one of my favorite pedals. I think he custom built a low pass filter or some sort of filter for John Davis. I think he only made one of them. It's one of the greatest sounding pedals I've ever heard. I just think there are people making super hip pedals like that. So modern, new things. And the other end of the spectrum, stuff that you really can't buy anymore because they don't make it. You can only get them used. Like the old Meatbox FX32, the old Boss Tremolo Pan, stereo tremolo pan, amazing sounding funky pedals. This one, super clean and an amazing kind of high-end sounding pedal. The Meatbox, not so much, kind of junky, but really amazing effects nonetheless. DOD, just, they always make me smile. I see DOD and I'm like, oh boy, like what am I gonna get? Because the pedals are crappy, a lot of them, but that is essentially what I like so much about them, is that I can get sounds that I never imagined and never expected and never heard before. In fact, this might be one of the worst octave pedals ever made, but I can't tell you how much fun I've had with it, and I would 100% recommend buying one and finding one. You're probably gonna have to go to Craigslist or Reverb or one of those places to get one, but I would totally recommend getting one because it's so weird, it's so funky, it's so lo-fi that you can really, when experimented with, get some incredible sounds out of it. And one of the biggest milestones and kind of innovation steps forward in pedals for me was when I gave up the old Line 6 DL4 because this was my looper before. 14 seconds of loop time, this was my looper and my delay. Except if I was looping, I couldn't use the delay at the same time. And you guys know me, I kind of like delay. So this was one of the best pedals I owned for a long time because it allowed me to loop and write and do all kinds of things. It was also one of the most frustrating pedals I owned because I couldn't use delay and the looper at the same time. Plus it was temperamental and you can see how badly it's held together with tape and it's Frankenstein now. I'm not even sure if it works anymore. That's how long it's been. To go from this to something like the TC Electronic Ditto series. This is the X2. Really dig the X2. Been using it since it came out. I also have the Ditto Mini, the Ditto Stereo, the Ditto X4. I have all of them. They're great, great looping pedals. Unlimited layers. I think 5 minutes of looping time, 10 minutes. I don't know. I put it this way. I've never even pushed the limits of the recording time, and I loop on pretty much every single gig I've played in the past 5 years or more. And then there are the treats. Then there are the little things, some of them you felt were unattainable at some point in the past that you would never own, that you could never afford, but they make unbelievably great sounds. And you can see I'm smiling just because I know I'm looking at some of the pedals here that I'm going to show you. It's so much fun to get to that point of putting the little treats and little bits of icing on the cake. Right here in front of me, right under my nose, is the Big Muff. Original Sovtek Big Muff. Juan Alderete turned me onto these. I tried a couple of his. They just blew my mind, the depth of these pedals. I own two now. I got nervous that if I owned one and it broke, I'd be screwed. So I cobbled together the money over several years. And you know, as I've done with everything with the pedal library, just a little piece at a time. Now I own two. They're unbelievable. It's not, as you can tell, something you really want to take on the road. You know, it's the old 9-volt battery thing. I have one that's been modified so you can plug it into to a pedal power, but it's heavy. It's not exactly signal chain friendly. Way more of a studio pedal for me, but it's one of the really fun parts of having such a pedal library and being able to get some of these kind of added extras at the end of the day. These are not all staples of the library. And talking about pedals that are not gain structure friendly and that are huge and cumbersome and don't have 9-volt inputs, again, run on batteries and are super funky, the Maestro. This is a pretty badass pedal, the Maestro Fuzz. It's old, it's retro, it's chunky. I think it's beautiful. It makes an amazing sound. It's more of a studio pedal. I don't think I've ever taken this on the road. You know, maybe I've taken it to a couple of local gigs, which are very few and far between, but it's a badass pedal. It was not cheap, I hate to say it, but it's one of those, like, one of those special moments, you know, one of those pedals that you kind of add on the very top of the library. Don't take it out of the house much. Costs a fortune, but boy, am I happy and very fortunate to own it. To that list, I would add things like the Bug brand Bit Crusher. That's another kind of treat pedal, like not necessarily essential, but a lot of fun. WMD Super Fat Man, probably the most complicated pedal I own. Definitely not a cheap pedal, but what a pedal. Unbelievable amount of things you can do with this. There's a video of me and Jojo Mayer playing at the NAMM show. Just check out on YouTube. Jojo Mayer, Janek Gwizdala, NAMM show. We're just playing duo. And every time you hear the filter, the wham, wham, those kind of sounds, it's this pedal. I had a monster pedal board for that gig, and this was a massive part of that. And some brand new additions to my pedal library, like the latest things. Simple, how simple? Like, we go from this crazy, stupid, expensive, like, distortion pedal, this ridiculous $1,000, you know, MP201, like, a CV controller, all these crazy pedals. And one thing I'm geeking out about so hard and enjoying and smiling about even when I think about it, never when I use it, is a volume pedal. Are you kidding me? It couldn't be more simple. It's an in and an out. Well, this one does actually double as an expression pedal as well, which is awesome. But the simplicity of it, it's a volume pedal. It makes things go louder. It makes things go quieter. That's it. And this is one of my favorite things right now. And in the same vein of simplicity, now this just makes things go louder, is the TC Electronic Spark pedal. I don't have the one in the bigger chassis. I just have the mini, which is perfect. And it's literally just a clean boost. So two of the simplest pedals in my entire library, and these are two of the pedals that I'm so happy about, probably wouldn't go on the road without them. Quick side note, pretty much 100% of my chordal, melodic, soloing sound uses delay. I don't know where I'd be without this one. This has been my staple delay since the first time I heard it. I've probably been using this thing for 5 or 6 years. You'll notice there's a one on there. That's because I own 1, 2, 3, 4 of them. Like every pedal that I seem to fall in love with, whoever's making it decides it's time to not make it anymore. So these are out of print, so to speak. They're just not made anymore. So I stockpile them, I number them in order of, shit, I don't know what in order of. I'll have to figure that out, but they are numbered. Maybe just so I can keep track of them, but I'm stockpiling them. I hope they are gonna get me through the rest of my career. And whenever I see one, I'll probably pick it up just like I do with the OC2s and anything else that I'm really, really dependent on in terms of my sound. I really wanted to just try and play through every single pedal, at least a few notes, but that's a mammoth task. It wouldn't be compact, it wouldn't be compelling, it wouldn't really fit in a video short enough for you to want to stick around and watch. So I've made a few examples of some of my favorite pedals, some of my favorite signal chains, and some ideas for you to perhaps start building your own pedal library and building your own signal chains. Just take them as a starting point, copy them, copy my settings, copy my signal chain, get a feel for it, and then go out on your own and experiment like I have. Hopefully you don't end up as crazy as me or with as much maintenance as I do with this pedal library. But most important thing is, and the thing I hope most for you, is that you end up having fun with it and discover something new, something creative, something innovative in all of this craziness for your music.
I thought I would start really simple with the OC2. I have an original one here, Japanese one, which you can tell is original, like the very first run that they made, because it actually has an R on the end of it, and it's called octaver instead of octave. I use the JoJo Mayer setting pretty much exclusively. If you look at, and I have 20 of these, I think. I have maybe 10 in storage, 10 here in the apartment. And if you look at every single one of them, they're all set the same way. Octave number 2 rolled all the way down, octave number 1 rolled all the way up, and then the direct level rolled all the way down, that smaller knob there in the middle. That's the JoJo Mayer nerve setting. He showed that to me. I'm pretty sure he showed that to Tim LaFave, to John Davis, to all you know, all the guys in that little scene. And it sounds like this. Very electronic sounding. You almost have a synth set up there without doing anything to it, just one pedal, which I'm pretty sure you can get a version of this on eBay for under $100 these days. And I always used to say I could probably do an entire electronic gig just using this pedal. I have the TC Electronic Nova repeater in this particular signal chain, and I have it set on a dotted eighth note, so that if I'm playing like, now you see I'm tapping, constantly tapping with my right foot to get this chord note tempo. Now you hear the notes tailing off there. I love that effect. It really encourages me to play less busy, to play less actual plucked notes on the bass, and let the delay pedal do a lot more of the work. As you can see by the settings, I have the level quite high, and I have quite a bit of feedback on this particular pedal, just so that it tails off nicely and I get a bunch of notes out of one pluck. So 2, 3, 4. There are a bunch of tails in there. And, you know, depending on the situation, I'll dial the feedback down a little bit if I don't want that many repeats. But that's a basic concept for playing like the dotted eighth note. So my next kind of thing that I would add to that signal chain is a bit of distortion to really give it a synth sound. I have an original Big Muff, Russian made. This thing is a beast. It's an amazing distortion pedal, just as a distortion pedal, playing with a pick, like a metal pick, and playing really kind of heavy music. But we take the delay off for a second. Gives you an idea of what that adds to the sound. So check out this other option for a distortion. Like I experiment so much with the middle pedal in this particular signal chain. This is the Maleco Heavy Industries. This is their Maleco Fuzz. It's a tiny pedal, number one. It's in one of those mini chassis, so it's really easy to take on the road. There it is with the delay again, creating that kind of delayed dotted eighth note electronic music effect. One crazy old pedal I started to really come to love is the old DOD FX25 envelope filter, the so-called Kermit Green version. I think it's the first edition of this pedal. And it's really simple. Again, one on-off switch and two knobs. It's got range and sensitivity. Your touch with your right hand is really what drives the pedal. So you can get this really subby sound if you play soft with the right hand. And you can really make it go wah the harder you pick with your right hand. Now Now, on the flip side of that old school Kermit Green FX25 envelope filter by DOD, there is probably the most complicated pedal that I own, I think, which is the WMD Super Fat Man. It's also an envelope filter, but boy, as you can tell, does this have a lot of options. I can't state this enough that I'm, you know, as much as I have a ton of gear and I use a ton of gear and I own a ton of pedals, I'm not a gear guy in terms of I don't understand how this parameter works and that oscillator and this low pass filter and all those things. I don't actually understand the technical ramifications of those labels that are on each parameter of each pedal. The way I do it is plug them in, turn them on, and start twisting knobs until I get a sound that I really dig. That didn't take long because apparently, miraculously, there's a sound in there that I really dig. I barely did anything for that. Oh, that's nice. When you put the OC2 in there, you get a little sub. Now, if I mix in a little distortion, so what I'm doing there, this is the Frantabit, Iron Ether Frantabit, and this is a bit crusher, and I'm just kind of degrading the sample rate there to make it a little dirtier. Tons and tons of fun. Now, the Frantabit is something I've been using as a distortion as well as a bit crusher. Big fan of using the Frantabit as more of a vocal quality to my sound when I use the Baby Elephant setup, which I will show you now. So this is the Baby Elephant setup. I was going to grab my Federa because that's the bass I use mainly to play in when I'm playing soloistically and melodically. That's the bass I play. But I plugged the pedals in and stuck with the jazz bass for now. And it just goes to show that it, you know, this sound will work no matter what bass you're playing. And it's really very simple. I have the Frantabit, which is giving me that fuzzy kind of... In fact, if I take... That's totally dry with the Frantabit. So that's the distortion it's giving me. Then I add the delay to that, back to my kind of regular delay setting. And I have it on one of the stereo settings on the TC Electronic Nova repeater, but I'm playing it through a mono setup, which is why I get... That's why I get that kind of pattern. That's actually my delay sound. It's not an eighth note or a dotted eighth or anything like that. It's a stereo setup. It is a quarter note plus a dotted eighth. I think the quarter note is meant to come out one side and the dotted eighth is meant to come out the other. But because I'm playing through a mono setup, they both come out in the same place. That's what I use for my delay sound. And when you add in the super shifter, which I have set simply to an octave up, and I think I have everything mixed out. I generally have the natural, the dry direct signal mixed out. You can hear a bit of the dry signal there, then I kind of mix that out. That's a ton of fun. You know, I have hours and hours of fun using that. And of course, if you heard me play before, you've heard that effect. And this is what the setup is for what Bob Reynolds called it and Roslyn and those guys called it, the Baby Elephant sound.